all. It's very nice to see all of you. Now, I think a lot of you have asked this question even before, and some of you may not have heard the answer. And to some of you, I think it makes you very inquisitive to see a learned person or a wealthy person or a person with very lot of fame or power or with wealth getting ordained becomes almost a surprise to you. That's why this topic has been put on the table. Because it's like, if everything is okay, if you are a successful person in life, why would one get ordained? That's the question you ask me. So as if the renunciants are people who got nothing to do and they are losers. So they got nothing to do, they are not successful, they just choose to be no one. Leave me aside. You look at Lord Buddha's life. Now, he was destined to be a king. He was born as a prince who is destined to be a king. So he had a lot more things than us. He was very knowledgeable in almost every field that a king should know. He was trained in all the fields. And he had all the wealth, the power, the fame. But he left all that. Why is that? Normal people, all of you, normally chase them. You follow them. You want to have things. Every mother or a father would like to have their child. They would like to see their child becoming a king, going to the top. That's a desire of all mothers and fathers. So, there is something that actually triggered me. So when I was born into a Buddhist family, but I didn't understand Buddhism much, but when I was little, I understood one thing that hit me. That was around when I was 10, one day I was in the temple with my grandmother. I used to go to the temple a lot with my grandmother. And they were offering me flowers, and the venerable was asking to repeat something after him. The stanza that we chant when we offer the flowers. You all have heard that, I think. Pujayami Buddham Kusumeni Nena Punyena Metena Padamukha Puppam Milayati Yatai Dhamme Kayo Tatayati Vinasa Bhava. So when he asked me to chant that, I asked him, what's the meaning? I always ask a lot of questions when I was little. So my grandmother said, don't ask like that. You normally don't ask questions straight from a monk in our culture due to respect. So I was a little child, I didn't know all that. So I asked him, why are you asking me to chant? What's the meaning? So he encouraged me. He told my grandmother, no, it's okay for her to know. So he took time to explain. And Venerable said, look at all those flowers in the asana, you know, where we keep the offer the flowers. It was a huge table. We had a huge reclining Buddha statue, maybe from here to there. So it was a huge place where you can offer flowers. So there was so much of flowers there. And he said, look, those pretty flowers there. But can you see in that corner, you know, some of them that's pushed to the side, they are actually already withered. They are no longer beautiful, they are already, you know, about time to throw away. It's already dead. And it's the same way that we ourselves will go through that. One day, you know, you're very young, you're very nice, you have a lot of energy. In the middle age, your grandmother is kind of old, but all of us one day will be like that flower. We'll fade away, we'll die. And that's what we chant. Looking at these flowers, we try to reflect on our life, that one day we will die the same way. Actually, I can remember maybe something like a lightning struck me. So that was okay. But after coming back home, I remember I had a dog who was growing up with me. It lived until about 18, 19 years with me together. And at that time it was about 10 years old too, about maybe 8 years, maybe 2 years younger than me. So about 8 years. And I used to love it very much. I was the only child in my family. He was my brother, sister, everything. So I used to love it very much. But when I went home that day, I realized, you know, his name was Lucky. He might die one day. You know, if he dies, it will hurt me a lot. It will be very difficult to bear the pain. So I must not get too close. So I remember that thought going through to my head. And then after a few years, my grandmother died. And I used to be very close to her. I used to be very close with her, more than my mother, because the parents, they go to work. You only see them at night. But you spend a lot of time with your grandparents. And my grandmother was very close to me. And I learned a lot of things from her. And when she died, it was a bit unbearable to me. I felt like my whole world, my best friend, is gone. And I realized that suffering that I was going through is because I loved her a lot. I was very close to her. So after that, I think that experience kind of had an impact on me afterwards. And slowly, slowly, I can remember detaching from my little dog also. And when it died, actually, pretty much I didn't have much grief. I was expecting it to die at any time. So I grew up like that. Anyway, around the same time, I had a lot of questions about myself. What will happen when I die? Because this death was something that was significant to me now in my life. What will happen after death? So when I asked the monks, not many could answer. So I was reading books. We had a library at home. And I was reading a lot of books, psychological books about the mind, about the life after death, some books written by even some Westerners. So then, at that time, there was a person who was offering some meditation. And he said, "Do you know who you are? Where did you come from? Where will you go after you die?" So then I started to follow them. My mom and me, we all went to meditate. And my teacher, he was my first teacher, who taught me. So this was actually when I was around 10, 11, after that incident that happened at the temple. So I learned to meditate under him. He was in a mountain. We used to go there during the weekend and we used to meditate. And he didn't give me the answer. He told me, "You have to find it for yourself. But I can show you the way." He said, "You don't have to believe blindly. If I say you will go to hell, you know, you don't have to believe that. If I say you're going to go to heaven, you don't have to believe that too. And you don't know whether hell and heaven exist. What you can do, I can show you to actually see these places for yourself." And I was very interested. And because I have read a lot of these books about the mind and psychic powers, I knew about psychic powers, the mind powers, and I was very interested in them too. I have heard about the jhanas, developing these hasina meditations. I have heard what you can do, what the arahats have done long time ago. And I have heard about the rishis who live in India, so who can levitate, who can float, who can even travel. So that was one of the things that interested me to keep going on. So my teacher actually hooked me with that. He said, you can find out for yourself, you can do all this to yourself. So he said, but one thing you have to do, you have to meditate every day for 1 hour. So as a child, I used to actually wake up at 4 because I had to go to school. By 6 o'clock my school van comes from where I live. I went to school in Colombo, so it takes 1 hour drive. So my school van comes at 6 o'clock, so 5 a.m. my mom wakes me up and I had to get ready. And it was a real struggle actually for her to get me up at about 5 o'clock, a little child. But after going to this meditation, after my teacher said to me, look, if you want to find these answers, you have to meditate 1 hour every day when you wake up. So I had no choice that I had to wake up at 4. So, but because I was interested, actually gave me a lot of strength and it became a normal habit. So no longer my mom had to wake me up. I used to wake up at 4 and meditate 1 hour every day to gain 5 psychic powers. To know what will happen to me when I die, to see the hells, to see the heaven and all this and that. So anyway, so I started my journey like that. And when we go to meditation, later on we would stay the whole weekend. My mom had to stay with me. So we meditate. And then on Sunday evenings we go back home, and then Monday I go to school. But there was a time after 5 or 10 years of this practice continuing, I felt like, you know, what's the point you going back to this school and having to do all these exams? When I'm in the mountain, I'm so happy. I'm so peaceful. As a child, I think, your mind is almost very pure. Not like an adult. So whatever my teacher taught me, actually I did better than the adults. So I was actually gaining into a lot of the good meditation, getting into good meditation, getting into very deep, peaceful states of mind. So to me, not to be in that state was really upsetting me. So I would cry sometimes on Sundays when I have to go back. I would plead with my mom to leave me there, but I had to study. So my teacher kept saying, you must not hurt your parents, don't create any apusala karma, you must listen to your parents, go to school, study, and then later you can make a decision. So then there was a stage where I wanted to go to Himalayas. They never let me go there too. So anyway, I grew up like that and I had to study, and I thought after doing my A-levels, I could full-time retreat into the forest. But that also never happened. My parents all come from a very educated background, so they wanted me to go to uni. But then I knew, because I was the only child, they were very close to me. I wanted to kind of start to have some separation, some distance. So I said to them, well, with one agreement, I will go to uni, not in Sri Lanka. If you let me go to any foreign country, okay, I will study. So what happened, they agreed. And it happened that I landed in Australia to continue my higher studies. And when I came to Australia, actually it gave me more freedom of practice. In Sri Lanka I only had weekend, you know, you go there on Saturday, Sunday, you have to come back. But in Melbourne, what happened after I come to Melbourne, actually I met Ajahn Brahm. So normally when I go to the temples, I didn't have much trust and faith in that traditions. I didn't ever think even I want to become a nun. All I was interested is to be in the forest, to go to the Himalayas or just to, you know, be in the forest meditating. But after I met Ajahn Brahm, at that time also I was studying. I was doing my biomedical degree. So I finished it. But during that time when I was studying, I used to go to retreats, now 10-day retreats in Perth, in Sydney. And then after that, when I have vacations, I used to go to Burma, Thailand, and I went went for 3 months silence retreats. So after I have finished my studies, I actually started to contemplate, what do I really want to do now? I also have not just studied one degree, I had many, many, many other things that I was interested in and I was studying. And after I had completed this biomedical degree, my mom started to keep saying, okay, now it's time for you to do a PhD or try to do the MBBS. So I thought, you know, there's not going to be an ending to this. And to me, the hour of good meditation, whatever that happiness and peace that gives me, that into my mind, I never got that from any worldly things. Not from the studies, not from even finishing a degree and getting the certificates, not from having the money, the house, the car, I had everything. So when I was studying, I was working part-time too, so I managed to buy a house. I managed to get a brand new car that I wanted, and everything I wanted, I had in Melbourne. So none of them managed to give me the happiness that it could give me when I was in a retreat. So slowly, slowly, I started to contemplate, okay, I still haven't found my answer, but I started my journey. But I know I'm in the right track, and I could kind of see things and the meaning of life. So I had to make a decision and then try to negotiate with my mom. And during that time, when kind of a negotiation is taking place, actually I was in a retreat at Santi in Sydney. I only went there for 2 weeks retreat. And then Bhante Sujata also said, maybe stay a little bit long. I also stayed and I went on more pay. At that time I was working, so I stayed there for 1 month, the next month, the next month. Like that, I never come back. That's what happened. Because when I was in that forest monastery, it's a very lovely place. If you ever get a chance, you all can visit that place in Bandanoon in Sydney. Ajahn Sujato's monastery. That place, I realized, if you actually have a roof to be under, and if someone is actually feeding you, that's all you need to live. And it gives you so much lightness. And I was only there for a short time at the beginning, and I started to think, my goodness, how the monks must be feeling. So they must be so light. Me just being there for a couple of months, I started to feel so light because I didn't have the burden of the house or a car or anything there. So I thought, you know, I must be so stupid to hang on to those things, which gives me so much heaviness into my mind, so much worries, so much trouble. So slowly, slowly, all that attachments and the desires I had for them, I could see they are slowly, 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 slowly fading away. And I didn't have anything actually to hang on to go back to. There was nothing that interested me in that side. So that's what kept going while I was there in my mind. So I started to enjoy my stay there. I had more time to meditate and more time to help all the Bhantes. At that time, I was only Anagarika there. So I had to be the kitchen manager, I had to be the driver, I had to do everything there. So I enjoyed helping the monks, doing everything, and at the same time, I was so free to do my own practice too, and with no headaches, no burdens, nothing to take care of, nothing to protect. Just yourself, just like that. So I started to realize the lightness that comes with the living simple, with non-attachment, nothing in your bag. So I decided then actually I will become a nun. And because I felt there was, if there's a secure place for you to stay and to practice, you feel very safe to be there and to you know, walk your path. I think what happens to a lot of people today, some of them, even if they have that desire in their heart, you know, just want to be left alone, want to practice, want to learn more Dhamma, but there's no place. If you all have a place, I think it will happen gradually and naturally. This is what happened to me. Because it, when there is a place for you to stay there, to study and to practice, your experience actually takes you further. And that happiness and peace you gain from your own practice will help you to go deeper, and also it gives you the contrast to compare the happinesses or the pleasures you get from the worldly side when you are in the engaged with the worldly things, when you are into you know, the worldly businesses. You can compare what you get from there, and also you know, when you read the Dhamma, it's so clear that Buddha says, by pleasing your senses, you will not get happiness. What you get is only a temporary pleasure, and at the end, you get a lot of suffering. Because everything is moved with the tanha, everything is rooted in the tanha. But more you actually try to let go of these things, that's when you try to find, you gain the lot more happiness and peace, because you're purifying your mind. So only after some time actually I realized that what Buddha is saying, how true it is. Then I realized why Prince Siddhartha left the palace. After 6 years of struggle, he became the Buddha, but he never went back to the palace. See, there was a choice. If the palace was a better place, if it offered a lot of happiness and peace, he could have gone back there. But he never went back. He remained with nothing. So that actually, when I contemplated a lot of the Dhamma, that just the basics that's being taught to us, has actually a lot more deeper meaning to it. So I started to understand slowly, slowly, this is what it's saying. How you gain a lot more happiness and peace is actually by giving up, by renouncing, by letting go of all your cravings, desires. You gain more happiness and peace. So to me, giving up a medical career or giving up your houses, your cars, didn't have any effect. Because it was nothing, but I saw they were bringing a lot of suffering. And even as a child actually, I used to live with a very light heart. If something happens, I would tell my mom, you know, I came with nothing, I take nothing. You know, when they encourage to do well or do this or that, I would say, why mom, why? Why bother all this? Why do you have to go to so much trouble? When we die, we don't take anything. And this is something, you know, was also working in my mind all the time when I was a young person. When we die, we take nothing. So why bother so much? Why strive so much when you can't take anything? Rather, I would live happily and peacefully. So this is how I happened to become a nun. Thank to Ajahn Brahm and Ajahn Sujata. And then later on, after my ordination, I went, met Bhante Puniji, and I took higher ordination under him. little bit. If you have any questions, you all can ask.
What were your parents' position when you say you wanted to be a nun?
Oh, okay.
Your parents are obviously very close to you.
But being in Australia for by that time maybe 10 years, it had created some sense of little bit of distance, not like before. Before I was like the ice. But being in Australia, slowly, that attachment was, I can see they can't control me as much as they used to. But later, when I was at Santi, after a couple of months, when I realized I will not go back, so I started to negotiate with my mom because she really wanted me to do higher studies. So I said to my mom, look, all this time I have done it because of you. Because my previous teachers actually encouraged me to be obedient, to do what they asked me to do and to make them happy. So I said to them, look, I think you have to be fair to me also, because now I'm getting old. And even if I do further studies, I don't think I will make use of it. So what's the point in me wasting another couple of years? I just want to now do what I like to do. I always wanted to live a peaceful life in a forest. So I said to her, look, can you please consider that? Now you have this degree, you keep all these certificates there. And I actually sent my degree. You know, it nicely comes with that hard thing with the ribbon, and I sent it to her. I said, you can have it, I did it for you. But I don't think anymore I want to waste my time. So, would you like to see a stressed daughter, or you like to see a happy daughter? Because I'm more happy when I'm meditating and living in the monastery. I'm very stressed out there. Which is so true, isn't it? And in today's world, you see there's no one you can find who is not stressed. So I asked my mom, what do you prefer? For your daughter to be stressed there, or to see a happy and a peaceful daughter? So she couldn't argue with that one. So slowly, they were okay. Because it happened gradually. I went to Santi in 2006, I think somewhere in May or April, and I got my next ordination, ceremonial ordination in 2007, so after 1 year. So there was a period of cooling off period. Yeah, so always I kind of contemplated the Buddha's life as Prince Siddhartha. And to me, that him seeing this old man, sick man, and a dead person, it wasn't just a story or it wasn't a superficial thing. It hit me as well. Because I have seen many, while I was actually studying, I used to work for the Department of Human Services. And part of my job was to do case studies with these disability people. And I have seen how human beings suffer. And I have seen old people bedridden, my own grandmother, the other grandmother. And I have seen people in the hospitals, and I have always reflected, my goodness, you know, if this happened to me, then I can't go to the toilet, I have to wear a pad, someone comes and feed me, someone comes and bathes me when they want to bathe me. And you know, you become so vulnerable. You're still alive, you can talk. But no longer you have the strength or anything to do for yourselves. And I have seen it often. And I have reflected, you know, what if that happens to me? And not only in this life, it will keep happening. If you are born again, you will have to go through this whole process again. You know, as a little child, there's so much suffering. And when you grow up, studying is a suffering. In one way, it is a stress and a suffering. And then after you complete all that, you have to go to work. That's another suffering. And then after that, you know, there's whole series of suffering. There's nothing else. So I saw this suffering, you know, everywhere. What's there is suffering. So I thought, I better find a way out of this. Otherwise, what's the being, you know, use of being a medical scientist, actually, when you suffer? You try to help others. I had to actually convince my other mother in Melbourne, because I, one of my neighbors, she's like a mother to me. So I even call her mom. She don't have any daughters, so I was her daughter. So she told me, at that time when I decided to stay longer in that monastery in Sydney, she kept calling me and told me, you are involved with this research. That was a great research, which was actually to do with the bats. You know, bats' saliva, they found that if you administer that to a person who had a stroke, normally a person, when they get a stroke, they have to be hospitalized within 3 hours. If you being admitted after 3 hours, the doctors can't administer any drug because it will only make them worse and die quickly. So everyone had to watch them dying slowly. Either they themselves recover or they die. So within 3 hours you have to go to the hospital. Otherwise doctors can't help. But with this bat saliva, they found that whatever that compound that was in that bat saliva, a particular type of a bat that actually you know, sucks on the blood of the other animal, they insert something into the blood where, you know, blood will not clot. So they extracted that, and then they managed to, when I was involved, it was on the third clinical trial, so it was actually very much on the verge of getting a drug out of it. And it was made into the ABC and all the news, because in the medical field it was a huge discovery, because with that drug, a person, the doctors can administer that to a person who had a stroke up to 9 hours. Pretty much that means there's a time of saving that person, because there's a whole day, pretty much, you know, half a day is there for someone to bring the patient to the hospital. So there is a chance of saving these people who get a stroke. So it was a huge breakout for the medical field. So my mom kept saying, you know, you are involved with that. Your brain is very valuable there, you know, your ability to help the society, to help these people, isn't it more valuable than you hiding away in a forest? And so she kept saying, you must come and serve the world. And I kept telling her, look, even if we manage to keep that person alive, we manage to do something about it, but we can't make them not fall sick again. You know, the doctors only can help to a certain extent. They can't make the person free from getting sick, getting old. That's the natural process that's going to take place. We only can fix things temporarily. So I kept telling her, look, it was the Buddha who gave the best medicine, who actually managed to find the permanent cure for this aging, sickness and death. And especially the doctors can't prevent people from dying, really. When the time comes, we all have to die. No matter even the 100 doctors are going to be around you. You know the story of the Alexander the Great? The Emperor Alexander the Great? You know, when he planned his funeral, and he told his wise ministers, this is how I want my funeral to be. How? One instruction is, he said, have my hands out, like this. So they have to have a special coffin. Hands and legs all out like this. And then he said, I want all my treasury, all the gems, the gold and everything, to be put on the road from the place where the coffin is going to take out from my place to the cemetery. Everything to be outside, on the side of the road. And I want all the physicians and the doctors who treated me, all the doctors, to be on a parade to the cemetery. So they ask, this is very strange. Why? Why you want to have your hands like this? He said, there's great wisdom here. He said, I want to show the world. I want the people to understand. No matter how much treasure that I have gained, I have accumulated throughout my life, that I'm not taking even a penny with me. Here, my palms are open. Everyone should be able to see that. Huh? Why the doctors? Why you want to have these doctors all lined up to the cemetery? He said, well, I had the great wealth to, you know, employ all these doctors. They all come to treat me, hundreds. But none of them could save me from my death. I want the whole world to know that too. See, there's great wisdom in that. So this is the biggest thing, you know, we're all going to die. And not only die, I mean, before that, we will fall sick, we will get old. We have to go through this natural process, which is not very healthy. Oh, it doesn't bring much happiness. So I had to convince her, saying, you know, there is physical suffering, there is mental suffering, and none of them we can eradicate. Doctors only can temporarily treat them. It was Buddha who managed to actually cure people from all kinds of suffering once and for all. Because he managed to find the cause, the root cause of this suffering. Why we go through this mental and physical suffering? The root cause. And he managed to eliminate that. And after he done his part, he told the world that I have managed to get rid of all this suffering and I'm free from death. If you like, you can also follow me. I can be a guide. I can tell you how I did it. And he laid the path. He showed the path. It's a noble eightfold path. And here it is. We all have that recipe. It's not a secret. See, normally the scientists have a lot of secrets. They don't give out because they are very scared the others will find it out before them. And they don't want that. But Buddha just gave it all without hiding a single thing. He laid out the recipe for you all to be free from all physical and mental suffering. So I was more interested in actually bringing the suffering to an end. And I found this is the best position to be in. Because you have to have actually free time to do that, to contemplate on the Dhamma, to practice, to meditate, to all that. You have to be free from these unnecessary burdens and attachments. And when you're so free, you have time for yourself. So I managed to convince her and tell her, look, I'm doing a greater service now. Because I can help people in a more meaningful way. If I can find myself to be free from suffering, then I can help others also. And you know, you all know, I'm not also a full arahat, but you all know that we still come and give you all Dhamma talks. While we are on our path, walking, we still like to share and help you all because I see that suffering in everyone. We all suffer in one way or another. So this gives me greater joy and more happiness to help others in this way. Because that's more meaningful and it will have a permanent effect. If you do understand the Dhamma, if you can apply it in your daily lives, you also can free yourselves from suffering and live happily and peacefully. So, I managed to convince people who try to tell me, you know, I'm escaping. I'm not giving my brain or I'm not, you know, utilizing my intelligence to what they thought was the more important side. I managed to convince them and none of them actually could argue. So they are also happy now.
Probably my karma is such. I didn't have to go through that much of a difficult period, but there was one interesting thing that happened. There was a monk in Sri Lanka actually who was into this Bhikkhuni ordination, and he was supporting me then. When I was in Sri Lanka in 2010, he told me, you know, we are supporting the Bhikkhunis to be Bhikkhunis, but there's no very intelligent, very courageous nuns to come and take it up and do a change in here. People like you, you shouldn't be just staying in Australia. You should come to this country. There's a big struggle for the nuns. There's no recognition for the nuns. There's no support for the nuns. If there is, it's very little. People like you must be here. This is your motherland. You must be here. You must consider to become a Bhikkhuni, and you must try to do something to this country. So I said, okay, Bhakti, I'll think about it. Because I'm more interested into meditation. Even when I go to Sri Lanka, all I do is I go to a forest monastery somewhere. And then later, when I was discussing with my teacher, Bhante Pumaji, and I said to him, look, I got no problem with ordaining. If it has a meaning and if it's going to help and support and strengthen the Bhikkhuni Sangha in Sri Lanka, and if I can be any help or support to them, I would like to become a Bhikkhuni, but I want you to be the preceptor. I will not have any other teacher because you're already my teacher, and I would like you to be my preceptor. So I have to tell you, there was a bit of a thing there, because Bhante Pumaji was someone who was very opposed to the Bhikkhuni ordinations at the beginning. When Bhante Piyananda in America was giving ordination to the nuns, actually Bhante Pumaji has made a comment to him, said, you will go to hell for doing that unwholesome act, for making women, you know, giving the full ordination. And Bhante Piyananda, when he was here in KL, we all three were there, and when Bhante Piyananda found out my preceptor, Pachaya, is Bhante Pumaji, he laughed. And he said, haha, now we work and meet in the hell.
So I asked, what was the story behind? So then he said, you know, Bhante Pumaji was really against making the Samanaris Bhikkhunis. So he asked me, what did you do to Bhante Pumaji to change his mind? And I said, I did nothing. But what happened? Also, at the same time, when I was practicing under Bhante Pumaji, he saw I was only interested actually in practicing. You know, he knew in and out of me. And also, he knew I wasn't doing this to fight for the feminine rights. I wasn't fighting for it, or I wasn't doing it for the sake of doing it. And he told me, if you get a higher ordination, that will really help your practice. You know, more Vinaya means you have to keep the Vinaya, and it will help to protect you from a lot of the other defilements that can normally affect you. Now, when you have the Vinaya, the Pratimoksha, you have to follow them, so that will become a help to advance in your practice, to get closer to Nibbana. So he finally agreed, and he said, if it's going to help your practice, and if it's going to help in many other ways, okay, I will become your preceptor. And he went to see the other monk, and he told him, and also he went to see Bhikkhuni Kusuma, and then he introduced me to her and said, look, would you like to ordain her? She's my disciple, and could you be the Bhikkhuni preceptor for her? And this is how he came to the scene, and he was actually quite okay, but with one condition, not to fight for the human feminine rights. And I accept that.
So where is your base now? Sri Lanka or
Melbourne? Baseless.
Homeless,
baseless. I'm in Australia here and in Sri Lanka.
Bangladesh?
Wherever the Dhamma takes me, I go with that. Not really. My ordination happened in India actually, in Bodh Gaya, on a Vesak day. Yeah. That was kind of not planned, but it happened that way.
Your parents were there?
No. I was going to get ordained to Sri Lanka, so I was going on my way to Sri Lanka from Burma. I was in a 3-month silence retreat. Then I wanted to visit Bodh Gaya before my ordination. So I went to India, Bodh Gaya, and then from there I had my ticket to go to Sri Lanka to get the ordination. But when I was in India, in Bodh Gaya, it was the Vesak May time. It was just the Vesak period. I was just only a couple of weeks before. So the head Bante in Bodh Gaya, he said, well, you know, you don't really have to go to Sri Lanka to get ordained. You know, I'm quite interested in ordaining you here. Would you like to? So I said I had to get permission from my parents and from the nuns in Sri Lanka that who were looking forward to having me there. And then finally he managed to get permission and he convinced them. He said, you know, look, what's more interested is there's no such a place like a Bodh Gaya and such a day like a Vesak day coming together. Don't be so silly to have her there to be ordained. I ordain her here. If you like, you can come here. But I discouraged them to be there because I knew it would be very emotional to them. So we had the ordination there, but after the ordination only I went to Sri Lanka. Yeah. Yes? No, the whole thing, what will happen then, it will be the anger, it will be your pride, it will be your ego that will come to the surface. You're strengthening yourself, sense of self. So whole aim of our practice is to actually let go of all that. To be no one, to find the non-self. So it's best you let go everything, but you continue with your practice. And why we should take up the higher ordination is because it's going to help us to find that, to free ourselves from suffering. This will take us closer to Nibbana. This is why it's called Pathimoksha. So it's not something that we should fight for. Like Bhante was saying, Venerable Arya Santini was saying, I didn't become a bhikkhuni to get recognition. That's not the reason. I got the higher ordination because I want to keep the Vinaya, practice the Vinaya, and that's going to help me in my practice towards the Nibbana.
Who's going to change the mindset of the monks in this 21st century, still trying to object and oppose to the ordination of the nuns?
No, I think from my experience, this is my experience. Now, Bhante Punnaji is someone, a very hard one. Like when he sets up his mind on something, you can't change him. And he's a very learned monk, he's a very senior monk. I think you're very familiar to Bhante. If someone like that can be changed, I believe, you know, anything can be possible.
But I think the whole collection of nunhood should stand up and challenge the order.
The real way to win is to do your own practice, to be humble, to do your own practice, and at the same time you do your service to the others, you continue on your path. And one day they will realize what they're opposing is what for. And it's a waste of their time.
Yeah, it will be the opposite of the women's rights.
So, you know, Buddha actually says in a nice way sometimes, you know, let the barking dogs bark. When they are tired, they will shut. You continue to do your thing. If you know you are doing the good thing and the right thing, you continue. And this is exactly what Arya Santini was saying. So, you know, nothing can stop us. You do what you have to do. You continue. So to do that, you really have to be stable. You have to have a very strong mind, very stable mind. You have to have a lot of patience. You have to be able to endure a lot of these things. You have to have a lot of loving kindness. So, you know, you have to keep practicing, continue your practice and develop these qualities. That's your guard. Yeah? Let the others do whatever they want to do, because one day they will turn around, one day they will change. And change has to happen within themselves. We can't do much. We have to lead by example, you know, living on non-violence and being so humble. And we have to kind of just continue with your path. If we get caught up in this fighting, you will never reach Nibbana. You have to keep being born a couple of times. So now, anyway, I have had some discussions with this Nayaka Theros, and I used to say in a laughing, and I would tell them, Bhante, I think I have been a monk in my previous life who have opposed the nuns. Now this life, I have to be born as a woman and be a nun and to, you know, help these nuns now. But I would not put it to that side, but I would tell, and because sometimes I do feel that maybe we have been like that and now it's a repay time. Time to pay off, and we have to clear the path. We may have laid some obstacles. So we have to clear it now. So I say that, and they start laughing and they say,